Of artistic freedom. My name is Jan Lute Eriksen, General Manager of Safemuse. Welcome to this gathering here at Centralen in Oslo. and welcome to you all. They're out on the World Wide Web. The past days, we have gathered artists and those fighting for artists at risk to talk, discuss, and work together. Our network across the globe has come together digitally, and some of us here physically in Oslo. Themes for this year's Safe Havens Conference has been in-country and in-region protections of creatives, state or non-state forms of repression of freedom of expression, the mental and emotional impacts of the risks, threats and attacks, building resilience, the current state of artistic freedom and risk challenges, and not the least, true safe havens, the artists and activists meet and share experiences and thoughts, challenge viewpoints, building network and supporting each other. So through the Safe Haven Conference, we are creating space and sharing stories. And at this closing event, we have the honor to present the following performing artists: Yasmin El Baramavi, an Egyptian musician and composer, icon guest artist in the city of Malmö; Carlos Cartoon, aka Gato, a Guatemalan breakdancer, now a Safemuse guest artist in Tromsø; Ahmed Tobasi, a Palestinian actor, director and educator; and Rezan Batula, Kurdish performing artist based in Paris, both of them here, the courtesy of Fanak Fun. Jess, drummer, percussionist; Hamid Sakisada, Afghan Hazara musician and former icon guest artist in the city of Harstad, here in Norway; and Naid Mubaleg, French Hazaran flute player. And moderator for the talks tonight is the director of the Norwegian Human Rights Fund, Ingeborg Moa. And artistic director for the whole thing here is Human Sharifi. Before we let loose, I have some small practicalities. When the concert is over, you're free to go to the bar and have a glass, but find your place afterwards. And please now turn off your mobile. And please do not photograph or film during this session. It will all be streamed and you can go back and check it out. And we also have a professional photographer here, so it will be documented. And those of you who prefer, please wear a mask. And then it's an honor to welcome City Councillor for Culture, Umar Sami Gamal, into and supporting the work of Safemuse and what we're all doing together. So please.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much. Dear friends, next week, the Nobel Peace Prize ceremony will take place in Oslo City Hall. This year, the prize honors and highlights fight for free and independent journalism. This year, Safe Havens Conference has yet again underlined the importance of freedom of expression, showing what happens when we lose the right to tell our stories, but also showing the role of solidarity in the creative community. I want to thank you for the work you do, for freedom of expression, for artistic independence. Oslo is a diverse city, home to more than 200 nationalities. The city government's vision is making Oslo a warmer and more creative city with room for everyone. The objective is for everyone to experience Oslo as an open and inclusive and tolerant city. This is why Oslo has been a city of refuge for writers since 2001. We have hosted authors, filmmakers, and journalists. We are working now on expanding our City of Refuge scheme to also be a safe haven for artists at risk and for human rights activists. So, dear friend, we are proud supporters of this conference and the work of Safemuse as an organization. We are doing this to support independent voices and because diversity in the arts is what keeps it vibrant and alive. And we are doing it because freedom of expression is under pressure in many parts of the world. As politicians, sometimes we are met with demands to take action against art that some see as wrong, too controversial, or even offensive. It is not in my place or any other politician's place to censor art, to remove works from public sphere. It is our duty to facilitate and to protect an open and informed conversation. Freedom of speech also protects opinions and works likely to provoke disagreement, appear controversial and provocative. Expressions that challenge our established views is a cornerstone of our democracy. My work as vice mayor focuses on culture as a foundation in our society and in our lives. Our libraries is an example I often use, an arena for democracy, open for everyone. This cultural foundation is important in building a fair and free future for our children and for our youth. I want to make sure that kids in my city, but also in all over the world, no matter their background, can participate and learn to express themselves through the power of arts and be free to do so. Then we have to give them the tools needed and encourage them to challenge us, to speak up and speak out and tell their stories. I want to thank you all here and for this conference, but also I want to thank you for your stories. Lastly, I want to congratulate the organizers of this truly global conference, all held together here at Central in downtown Oslo. Thank you, and thank you very much for taking your time to hear me. Thank you very much.
Thank you. thank you all. I can only say that I'm very glad that I'm the moderator and not the dancer. That was amazing. And thank you also, Yasmin, for your music.
Thank you.
It's such a wonderful combination of the oud, one of the oldest instruments in the world, and your innovative take on that. So
thank you. Beautiful. Thank you. Is it? Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Yasmin, you are from Cairo originally. You now live in what we both agreed was the Swedish city with the nicest accent, namely Malmö.
Yeah, okay.
But in Egypt, what is the risk of being an artist there today for you and for other artists?
Mostly when it comes to freedom of expression, you are in danger to go to be persecuted for saying anything you think of, not just politically, even sexually or religious or everything. You just say, like, you have an agenda, like the government wants you to talk about. And if you don't do that, you don't, at least you don't, you can't work if you don't go to jail.
You were also, I think, identifying as a women's rights activist in addition to a musician. And in many countries in the world today, not only Egypt, I think there are intersecting challenges that you said one of them is sexual identity, another is being a woman. How are you at risk from let's say, different intersecting threats as an artist today? Maybe not only in Egypt, but in the world.
Actually, being a woman is a problem in many countries. And yeah, just being a woman is a problem. when it comes to music, away from politics, it's also not expected from a woman to be a musician, maybe a singer, but not a musician or a composer. The same political danger is happening between both. I mean, both and all genders. But for a woman, there's also the sexual violence that can be used against her and to take advantage of that being stigmatized into society. So she will rather hide or avoid to be safe. Because also she knows that society will not go into support her, you know, so it's like she's losing from all sides.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's the thing there is, I think, that these layers of oppression and threats that mean that you are at risk.
Yeah, even your family would be a threat. Yeah.
Have you experienced that as an oud player who is also a woman, let's say, that there are people who think that you shouldn't be doing what you are doing because you're a woman?
I experienced when I was learning, teachers who refused to teach me because I'm a woman, or teachers who would teach me but sexually harass me. This happens all the time. And now, many people do not believe that I'm a musician. They think I'm doing it as a habit. Or even if someone sees me having my instrument walking in the street, they think I'm a student.
Okay. You know, like, or someone's assistant, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. So there's always underestimations.
Right.
And you need to trust yourself, like believe in yourself without any outer faith or like emotional support, you know. So this is like very, very personal that it's very subtle that affects you and your soul inside.
Yes, and that was my other question, because one way that it affects you is your safety, your security, and your ability to do what you do. But does it also affect your, as you said, your soul? Does it come out in the music or in your compositions and so on?
That's why mostly I'm just expressing my emotions. I'm not really making arrangements and music, and I'm just expressing. I cannot say it in words also.
Right.
So this is the only way I can express with. And I really care about now after some, like, first I was political activist and woman rights activist, and then a freedom of belief. Because whenever I go deeper with politics and with the revolution in Egypt, I realized that women are not included in the revolution and the rights are not included. So I shifted to women rights. Mm-hmm. And then I realized that women are not included in the society, not just the revolution, because of the religion that considers her something else. So now I'm talking about freedom of belief. Mm. And like in the three states, like in the three formats, you are in danger.
Mm. Mm. I think there's a very big tendency in all these areas to sort of say to women, well, this will have to wait. Is this something that you've also experienced? It's not a priority. We will deal with it when the revolution later, is over. Later, or
200,000 years.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've experienced that.
Have you? Yeah.
Yeah, from human rights activists who knows me in person, mm-hmm, friends mm-hmm. also, you know. So it's not just human rights, it's just even your friends are failing you, you know. Mm-hmm. So, guys, I'm human.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, it was a surprise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I think it hits us all at some point, those of us who are activists.
It was a surprise for everyone, for me and for them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now that you are in Sweden, you're not living under the same threats, but I'm sure there are other challenges in creating music. I have not lived in Egypt, but I lived for many years in the Middle East. I know my soul feels a different way when I'm there. What is your biggest challenge now that you are here in creating music and perhaps also in being an activist? Do you feel far away from things? Or
from the activist side, no, I'm not far at all. Mm-hmm. Like the danger can come here, and like almost, of course, not the same. But if I'm talking about freedom of belief, I can be endangered in my
right,
and like in anywhere, not in specific countries. And as a musician, my deal is interior.
Yeah,
and of course here I have more opportunities. Mm-hmm. I have more facilities to use, I have a studio to work in, and got a grant from Kotorada to produce my album. And there's a lot of people helping and networking from Icon and from Safemuse. Mm-hmm. So my challenge is like overcoming my musician trauma.
You know? Right.
Like there's kinds of traumas that I have, so this kind I'm dealing with now.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
And I think, if I may ask, and you decide yourself how you will answer, of course, but sometimes people say that making music is a response to trauma. Is it a response to trauma, or do you think that your music somehow reflects the trauma of having experienced, for instance, what you're describing as a woman?
Yeah, it was a reflection of a trauma. And now I don't want to do that because, the music I did for the last like 7 years, maybe cursing, but nobody knows that I'm cursing. but now the music I'm trying to do is like more happy dancing, dancing music with all the cultures I have in my head.
Yeah,
mixed together and producing. Like I'm trying to put myself out. Like this is me, because I have many things that do not go together.
Mm.
So, and I wanted to be happy, like enough traumatizing, like enough expressing traumas, you know, this is where I'm in the shifting point.
It's also a response. There's a quote that I like,
thanks a lot.
and I think it's someone said, be happy, it drives people crazy. It's also a way of resistance somehow.
Yeah, but in this situation, they go crazy anyway because I'm not crying, you know, or because I'm still standing. Mm. This is enough to make them crazy.
That's it.
Yeah, and even to say I'm proud of myself was very provoking, very extremely provoking.
Thank you, Yasmin, for the music that you produce and give us, and for who you are.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
جاء يكيني بهالمساحة من الخبر قالوا لي دورك في الشهادة ما حضر اصبر علينا صبر علينا وانتظر
نفسي أبيعه هالعمر لله وما استنى لو لحظة عمر نفسي أبيعه هالعمر لله وما استنى لو لحظة عمر هاي الشهادة بتنداي بالسمية رف القلب ادعي لي يا امي هاي الشهادة بتنده باسمي رف القلب ادعي لي يا امي
I'm watching TV with my dad, my mom, and four sisters. We see Ariel Sharon, the Israeli opposition leader, with hundreds of Israeli riot police storming Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem. That says, this is going to start a fire. Palestinians demonstrate peacefully against Sharon's visit. That says, Sharon's visit is about Oslo agreements that made us lose more of our lands. The Israelis counter the demonstrations with a brutal force. Hundreds of people martyred without no good reason. The Israeli invaded the whole West Bank. One of them, and the most attacked place, is Jenin refugee camp. The Israeli cut the mobile phone networks. I cannot call my parents. I tracked down a group of friends who stationed in house in the center, city center. One of them is my friend, Munir. To be surrounded with friends, I'm not scared anymore. One comrade bring a bag full of homemade bombs. You have to hold the lighter in one hand and the bomb in the other hand. You light the fuse and you throw the bomb through the window before it detonates in your face. I get things mixed up. I throw the lighter instead of the bomb. Poof. Munir and the other friends are not impressed. I bet even the Israeli sniper thinking, what the hell is this guy doing? So to compensate, I lean away out of the window and try to throw the bomb as far as I can. When suddenly, it feels like a massive bee sting. Everybody starts shouting, Tobas is shot! Tobas is shot! The other guys take me to the other end of the room. Munir start cutting my shirt. Bro, I am shot in the hand, not in the chest. That's what they do in the movies. Bro, you're cutting my best fake Armani t-shirt. The guys bandaged me up and they went out to fighting. I look at Munir. He's shooting at the distance. I don't know why I remember our days as a kids kicking the ball around. I think this experience gonna make Munir lose his shyness. I'm smiling. I wish he turned around to see me smiling. Burst of blood as the back of Munir's skulls flies off like a champagne cork. He's been hit by a sniper. Munir falls to the floor with a thud. I run to him. I try to push his brain back into his head. It's just like this. He's gone. Shai Munir is dead. I picked him up in my arms. A blood dropping from his head into my shoes. I took him to the bedroom. I lay him down. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.
As I start to recite the Al-Fatiha prayer, the whole house will start shaking. We have to run out of the house! One of the guys shouting, I want to say goodbye to Munir, but there is no time. We run out of the house. And later story, the soldiers catch us and took us to the prison. It's a long story in the prison, long story after the prison, but I decide to join a theater. And they chose me to go to a festival theater in Belgium. From Belgium, I took a bus to Hamburg. From Hamburg, I took a bus to Copenhagen. From Copenhagen, I took a bus to Gothenburg. From Gothenburg, I took a train to Stockholm. From Stockholm, I took a train to Oslo. All I know about Oslo, it lent its name to the peace agreement. Considering how that turned out, they bloody will own me a Norwegian passport. I give myself to the authorities. Why you have come here? My life is not safe in Palestine. Is this a lie? Half true or full true? What will happen with you if we send you back to Palestine? The Israelis will kill me? The conservatives will kill me? Maybe Allah will kill me? Clearly, God hates my part of the world. They sent me to a refugee camp in north of Norway, in a small village called Rognan. Two big mountains block the sky. There is no life. It's too dark. There is no sound. I'm scared that I survived the bullets and the bombs and the rockets in Geneva. In this terrible place, knowing no one, thousands of miles away from my home. But then I applied to the theater school and I got accepted. I bagged my bags and I went to Oslo. There are many artists from all over the world. We went out to nightclubs. We make plays. We talk in art. We talk in 23 years, I have been in a small box called Palestine. And now I'm outside, ready to eat the whole world. After 3 years, I graduated from the school and I get my Norwegian passport. For sure. Oh. Thank you, bro. Thank you. That's it. Thank you. Thank you.
Ah, I will give Ahmed Toubassi the possibility to put his shoes back on before joining me on stage. Thank you, Ahmed. That was a firework. I felt it here. I think that I speak for most of us. You and I didn't get to speak about this when we met before, but on that day when you were watching telly with your dad in Jenin, I was in Al-Quds.
Oh, yeah.
And I was in the middle of the demonstrations against Ariel Sharon, which I think is why it also hit me here. Mm. And I remember very well those days and how the Second Intifada started. Mm. As a protest, not only against Sharon, as you say, but also against what the Oslo Agreement brought the Palestinians. What is it now? I was going to say 20 more years of occupation, but it's 30 more years since Oslo, in fact.
Yes, I think this ambassador who was living in Tel Aviv, the Norwegian one who was really bored, didn't know what to do. So he came out with this idea. Let's have peace with Palestinians and the Israelis, for sure. But I think, yeah, it just this deal, it made us problems for the next 100 years, not just for the 20 years. Mm. Palestinians, that's the problem. Palestinians was not aware what exactly this agreement is about. They cheat us in our own language. Mm. They cheat us in our own negotiations without we even know what this really means. So we're still suffering from that deal. And I think we're going to suffer more because I think this deal made us late of what is going on now, like at least 25 years. Mm-hmm. So Israelis is above us 25 years. Mm. And for sure, with this time, with this technology, still we try to follow. But I don't think there is a hope from this deal. We need to finish it. We need to get out of it. Mm. Yeah.
I'm going to start with a question that I find a bit hard, but I'm sure you've been asked it before. So you're the artistic director now of the Freedom Theatre in Jenin.
Yes.
When I heard that I was interviewing you today, I was like, oh my God, the Freedom Theatre in Jenin. I love the Freedom Theatre in
Jenin. People will not believe you, you know.
But it's very, very true. I want to ask you still though, because you had many choices to not choose art. So why is it that in a situation like this, you chose art rather than, let's say, politics or even armed resistance?
I think what we always talk about is like the artist and the responsibility. Mm. When I came to Norway, for sure, I became someone new, like you have this, all this kind of life, but I lost something that it's why what I'm doing here. I have nice life, I'm trying to do theater, whatever, but I lost the thing make me really different from others.
Because you were here for 5, 6, 7
yes,
years,
yes,
right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Mm. But when I went the first time back and I did the play, direct a play for children, and you know, the whole team is like considering you the one who's gonna do something, and you see like they are helping you, not like here you need to write and bring this artist together. It's a big job. Mm. But there you see, like, if you try to do something, everybody went to help. And when I did that play, and you see children like coming out, singing the songs, memorize the text, 2,500 children attend this play. Said like, wow, this is what I want to do. Mm. These people need me. Mm. And you know, I come from Norway, still look like, I don't know, dancing, but, and people like, we need this energy. Mm-hmm. We are here, we want this kind of generator. Mm. So when I saw this, I went back to Norway 3 months. I see children, I see my camp, I see they need this kind of energy, they need this light. I took a break, 5 years, that's enough. Mm-hmm. I have to go back. Mm. So I went back, but for sure, the struggles that we face, it's not really people can imagine. And when I talk about it, people think I'm joking because I talk about it in a funny way, they think. But yeah, we with this theater, we get shots, we get bullets, we get bombs. People will come to your office with a gun telling you they want to do whatever. But it's a serious job that you're facing in many different incubations. The tradition, the PA, the Israelis, the teachers, the bad boys in the street, and you try to say we are here. This is space for anyone want to be different. This is space for anyone want to discover more freedom and limits and life for himself. Like we start as a Freedom Theater now talk about sexual identity, which is like the highest level of freedom and challenge. You can challenge the community. Mm. Our students who come to study, some of them, they're already different. And it's very clear, but they become very strong individuals to walk in the street as an identity. They have no problems to be different.
And this session today is talking about artists at risk. Does this, you know, I wear a band called Love is a Human Right.
Yes. Does
this going into identity issues and sexual identity issues, does it put you at risk in a different way than the risk of the occupation, the risk of...
Yes, yes. Mm. It's for us, like, you know, when you start to talk about women rights, children rights, sexual freedom, individual freedom. People will think you are a spy from the West and you're coming to destroy the tradition and the religion, which is like, this is nobody can touch it. Mm. And for me, it's like, I bust this level. Mm. And for me, each day, I will go any time to get the shot from a guy that he thinks he'll save Palestine or save Islam or save tradition from me as a foreigner, like even me in Jenin camp, I have my family.
Where you are from?
Yes, where I'm from. With my friends, with my family, they know who I am. They still like dealing with me as a foreigner, not like a real Palestinian somehow. Yeah.
You're experiencing, because you told me that in addition to these kinds of threats, you're also experiencing that finding funding for the theater is challenging, and there's a sort of administrative threat. Can you tell us a little bit about that towards the end?
Yeah, I mean, now as Freedom Theater, that we really against anyone gonna shut our mouth, even the EU, even the West who give us money, but that's not to make us shut our mouth to talk, express ourselves. Yes, we fight, we resist through theater against Israeli occupation, BA tradition, and now EU and Sweden, like CEDA, they are part of the new conditional fund, which is in somehow helping Israel to make Palestinians not touch any political issues connect to Israel. And like they said, in somehow, no one have to get benefit from our money if there have been in part of any work against terrorism, whatever. And that's me and me. I have been 4 years in prison. And you know, this is a very, and I had difficulties like which part I should present tonight. It's like 1 hour, 10 minutes explains all this. But yeah, this year, We didn't get fund because we don't want, we are against anyone.
Because you won't comply with.
Yeah, we don't want to anyone to control us. So this year, last year was a bit of a problem, and now we didn't get any money at all. Next year, it will be more problem. And I think most of the Palestinian art associations will face a real problems to open, especially Freedom Theater, where we have like a theater school and our work that and our programs we do. You know, you need to pay money, electricity, the theater itself, the people who works there. And we reduced even our team. Now we are just four. And I'm just like in art side, me and other three people who do like offices work. So it's really hard. And I think if that continue for next year, the problem is, if we close, there is no others.
Yes.
We'll do this kind of
exactly.
work. So yes, I hope things will change. Or we find someone in Norway.
Yes, yes,
no, not
yes.
AU. So
there are people here
open
with
your
connections,
cheeks,
I am sure. So let's hope. Yes. I just want to end by, I think that everyone who is here today and many of you watching, you are parts of changing the world. And I just wanted to end by a quote by one of my favorite writers, who's Indian, Arundhati Roy, who says, "Another world is not only possible. She's on her way. On a quiet day, you can hear her breathing." Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
تو هستم با تو آیم دوباره رفیق از من جدا شد وای بر من رفیق از من جدا شد رفت به غربت به غربت آشنا شد وای بر من رفیق از من جدا شد رفت به غربت شد وای بر مستور اسمی آدمی زاد و غربت رفته را کی میکند یاد و غربت رفت و روزی ناگهان مرد و خاک مرده را کی میبرد با بعد رفت و روزی ناگهان مرد و خاکی مرده را کی میبرد با تو دیوانه مرا کی برد خانه من مست تو دیوانه مرا کی برد خانه صد بار تو را گفتم کم خور دو سه پیمانه کم خور دو سه پیمانه صد دو سه پیمانه کم خور دو سه پیمانه
Eleni, Meltem, Ferdinand, any more left? Human, and of course. Thank you all, and thank you.